Recorded Books and RB Digital present Mayo Clinic Guide to Fibromyalgia, Strategies to Take Back Your Life. Written by Andy Abril, MD, and Barbara K. Bruce, PhD, LP. Narrated by Eliza Foss. Letter from the Editors. Every day, we see patients who hurt, aren't sleeping well, are exhausted, and have trouble concentrating. By the time they get to us, many of these people have been told that their symptoms are from stress or depression. Others have been told that they're wasting their doctor's time. Some have even been told that they're crazy. All the while, these people are struggling. They just want their lives back. They don't know what's wrong with them or how to make it better. This is the story of fibromyalgia. In our decades of experience at Mayo Clinic, we've worked with thousands of patients just like this, people with real symptoms of a real disorder known as fibromyalgia. We've seen these individuals use the strategies in this audiobook to return to productive, fulfilling lives. You can do this too. Fibromyalgia is one of the most misunderstood disorders in medicine today. With Mayo Clinic Guide to Fibromyalgia, you'll learn the facts about this disorder and the science behind treatments that can help you manage it. This audiobook also offers hope. Hope that fibromyalgia doesn't have to define who you are. Hope that fibromyalgia doesn't have to ruin your life. Hope that you can return to a satisfying life, even with fibromyalgia. We've watched as the strategies in this audiobook have transformed lives. With these tools and techniques, people with fibromyalgia are returning to the lives they enjoy. You can too. How to use this audiobook. Mayo Clinic Guide to Fibromyalgia is a comprehensive guide that provides answers and explanations about fibromyalgia. In this audiobook, you'll learn what fibromyalgia is and isn't, and how you can live a full, productive, enjoyable life with the condition. To help you easily find the information you're looking for, this audiobook is divided into four sections. Part 1. What is fibromyalgia? This section covers all the basics about fibromyalgia. You'll get to know people who have fibromyalgia and learn about their experiences. If you're listening to this audiobook because you have fibromyalgia, you'll likely relate to the last chapter of this section, which outlines some of the condition's biggest challenges. Part 1 kickstarts your knowledge about fibromyalgia and sets the stage for managing it successfully. Part 2, treating fibromyalgia. In this section, you'll learn about fibromyalgia symptoms and how to manage them. In particular, you'll discover how cognitive behavioral therapy can help relieve your symptoms. You'll also learn about specific programs that teach cognitive behavioral therapies. Medications and integrative therapies are also addressed in this section. Part 3. Managing symptoms. In this section, you'll use what you've learned about fibromyalgia and start developing techniques for managing your symptoms. You'll identify steps you can take to successfully manage fibromyalgia. Part 4. Living with fibromyalgia. To start this section, we'll revisit the people you heard about at the beginning of the audiobook. How are they managing fibromyalgia, and what are their secrets to success? You'll also get tips for talking with your healthcare team and your loved ones. If you don't have fibromyalgia but are caring for a loved one who does, you'll learn how you can provide support. Part 4 closes with an action guide that brings together everything you've learned and puts it into a daily plan you can start using right away. Finally, you'll find additional resources, including step-by-step exercise instructions, worksheets, and organizations you can contact for more information. Part 1. What is fibromyalgia? Your muscles ache. Your joints hurt. Your neck feels stiff. Your thinking often seems muddled. You're exhausted. You feel lightheaded sometimes. You can't sleep, or all you want to do is sleep more. With fibromyalgia, you may feel all of this and more, but have no idea why. To make things worse, maybe you've had every medical test imaginable, yet your doctor can't say what's causing your symptoms. The key to remember in all of this is that the symptoms you're feeling are real. Fibromyalgia is a real condition. It's also a treatable condition. There are ways fibromyalgia can be managed, which you'll learn about in this audiobook. In part one, you'll get a better understanding of what fibromyalgia is and what it isn't. You'll get to know its signs and symptoms and why it's so hard to diagnose. You'll also discover the many effects of this condition. Fibromyalgia can touch your life in more ways than you might imagine. Getting to know more about fibromyalgia is the first step toward managing it and living your best life now. Let's get started. Chapter 1. A Brief Introduction. Fibromyalgia is often misunderstood. Some people believe it isn't real, or that its symptoms are signs of depression, stress, or any number of other conditions. Mayo Clinic Guide to Fibromyalgia dispels common myths like these and outlines the facts about fibromyalgia. Fibromyalgia is indeed a real condition. It's a sensory disorder caused by a miscommunication between the nerves throughout your body and your brain, and it's treatable. In this audiobook, you'll learn what researchers have uncovered about fibromyalgia, what it is, what it isn't, and what causes it. Better yet, by the time you get to the end of this audiobook, you'll have a set of research-supported tools and strategies to manage your fibromyalgia symptoms so that you can return to the life you enjoy. People who use the strategies in this audiobook say that they help lessen the effect fibromyalgia has on their lives. They feel less pain and are less tired and depressed. If you have fibromyalgia, you may wonder what steps you should take and how to begin your treatment plan. If you think you might have fibromyalgia but don't know for sure, you may not know where to turn. Or maybe you're listening to this audiobook because someone you care about has fibromyalgia and you're not sure how to help. This audiobook is for every one of you. This audiobook offers guidance and hope that fibromyalgia doesn't have to rule your life. You can live well with this condition, and the pages that follow will teach you how. Let's start the journey by meeting two people with fibromyalgia. Gloria Story. I hadn't even heard of fibromyalgia. Gloria likely had been dealing with fibromyalgia for 20 years, but didn't know it. It isn't surprising that it took so long for Gloria to learn that she has fibromyalgia. When her symptoms first appeared, the term fibromyalgia was barely known. Gloria's medical history is also anything but simple. She's had kidney, bladder, and reproductive issues. At one point, she was in and out of the hospital for a month because of a viral illness. Gloria has also faced her fair share of stress. Her son was born with a heart defect, her daughter with a chest deformity, and her husband's work took the family on several cross-country moves. By 2001, Gloria was struggling. It became difficult for her just to get through each day. She was having trouble sleeping. She was tired all the time, and she felt worse by the day. "I ached from my head to my toenails," Gloria said. It seemed that any one or any combination of the life events Gloria was experiencing could be causing her symptoms. So Gloria met with doctors. After a thorough workup, she was told she had fibromyalgia. At first, Gloria wasn't sure what to think. "I remember asking myself, what will they call it next?" A condition that had taken on many different names over the years, Gloria recalls, "I hadn't even heard of fibromyalgia." Find out how Gloria learned to manage her fibromyalgia and how she's doing today later in this audiobook. You'll also hear from Gloria's husband and get his point of view on supporting someone with fibromyalgia. In Gloria's words, "You ache, you hurt, your muscles ache, your joints hurt. Every nerve in my body just begins to pulsate under my skin. Sometimes it's like every nerve is on fire. I could be standing at the sink doing dishes, and I feel like someone stuck me with a needle along those points in your body that they test. Oftentimes, I'll get a sudden stabbing pain in one of those areas for no reason at all." Justice's story. "I just couldn't shake the pain." At age 24, Justice may be the last person you'd think of when you picture someone with fibromyalgia. After all, the statistics are clear. More women than men experience fibromyalgia, and the condition often affects women who are middle-aged. But Justice isn't alone, and he's proof positive that anyone of any age can have fibromyalgia. Justice's journey with fibromyalgia likely started even before he was a teenager. At age 12, he was playing ice hockey and recalls asking his mom to rub his knees, ankles, calves, and elbows. His aches and pains eventually led him to a chiropractor and a massage therapist. As Justice continued to grow, so did his participation in sports. He played football and baseball and boxed. He planned to play baseball in college, but at the same time, he always hurt. The pain came to a head when Justice turned 17. "I ended up pulling my hip flexor off my hip and breaking my hip in the process. I spent my 17th birthday in the hospital," Justice says. This led him to stop playing baseball. When Justice went to college, his pain followed him there. "I just couldn't shake the everyday pain, the waking up and feeling like I got hit by a cement truck," Justice says. "It was hard every morning to get up. My muscles ached and they hurt. And it didn't matter if I worked out the day before or if I stayed home all day. It was the same kind of pain." Justice managed to earn his degree and chose to continue his schooling. But then he hit a wall. "It was getting to be too much," Justice said. "Not only is the pain affecting me, but now it's starting to affect my mind and how I'm thinking about things and how I'm thinking about life. The everyday struggle of waking up and not knowing what was wrong would put me in a place where, not that I wanted to kill myself, but I was in a place where I didn't necessarily want to wake up, because I knew waking up would involve dealing with the pain again and not knowing what was causing it." Questions started to swirl in his mind. "Do I want to keep doing this every single day? Who do I talk to? Is this just in my head? Am I making this up? Is this even really happening? I look like I'm healthy, but I don't feel like I'm healthy." Friends couldn't understand what he was going through, and that added to his misery, mentally and emotionally. Doctor after doctor had no answer to explain his symptoms. Justice felt alone and unsure of what to do. With his parents by his side, Justice went from doctor to doctor and clinic to clinic in search of an answer that would explain his symptoms. Ultimately, Justice learned he had fibromyalgia. He was shocked and angry when he was told he had a condition that wasn't going to go away. He was 22 years old. "I was so angry when I was diagnosed," Justice said. "Angry at God, and angry at the situation, and angry at anyone associated with fibromyalgia, because they said I had this condition that they said is probably going to be for the rest of my life, and they say there's no cure for it. And so, that made me angry." Doctors told Justice about a 3-week pain rehabilitation program that could help him, but he wasn't ready for it. "I can do this on my own," Justice told himself. "I can figure this out." He read everything he could get his hands on and found videos to watch, all with the hope that he would be able to figure out how to manage his symptoms on his own. 11 months later, Justice reached his breaking point. "I'm never going to be able to figure this out on my own," he remembers thinking. That's when he signed up for and took part in the rehabilitation class. Through the program, Justice learned ways he could manage his symptoms without medication and improve his quality of life. Learn what steps Justice took to manage his fibromyalgia and how he's doing today later on in this audiobook. Chapter 2. Fibromyalgia's Lengthy Journey. Through the stories Gloria and Justice shared in the last chapter, you got an inside look at what living with fibromyalgia is like day to day. If you have fibromyalgia, you may be able to relate to their experiences, or at least parts of them. Their symptoms may have sounded familiar to you. With all of this in mind, let's back up a step. What exactly is fibromyalgia? In this chapter, you'll learn about the history of fibromyalgia and the twists and turns that this condition has taken over time, leading to what experts and researchers know about it today. New condition or ancient history? As diseases go, fibromyalgia may seem like one of the newer kids on the block, but is it really? It's true that as far as recorded history is concerned, fibromyalgia goes back only 40 years or so, 1976 specifically. But a little more digging shows that it has roots that are hundreds, if not thousands of years old. Early origins. Fibromyalgia may date all the way back to biblical times, in particular to the story of Job. Job said that gnawing pains that would take no rest led to restless nights. If you have fibromyalgia, you may be able to relate to what this feels like. Back then, chronic pain that didn't seem to have a cause and couldn't be treated was seen as a punishment sent from beyond. This idea of pain as punishment lasted until 4th century BC. That's when Hippocrates, known as the father of medicine, came up with a theory that pain had a natural cause. He thought that the brain was sending fluid to the lower limbs, and this led to pain in the body. More fluid meant swelling and inflammation, which caused the pain. When medical records came into the picture, so did descriptions of aches and pains, now linked to fibromyalgia. In 1592, French physician Dr. Guillaume de Bayeux came up with the word rheumatism to describe joint and muscle pain. Rheumatism describes pain, discomfort, soreness, and stiffness that can affect how easily you move. The terms he used to describe muscle and joint aches are still used today. Experts continued to study rheumatism into the 18th and early 19th centuries. They learned that it affected not just joints, but also muscles and the body's soft tissues. They also found that fatigue and sleep problems were common, along with muscle pain and stiffness. Tender points, trigger points, and nodules, common terms used in describing fibromyalgia, came into the picture in the 19th century. To sum them up briefly, tender points are painful areas of tenderness. Trigger points are areas of the body that, when touched, cause pain in other parts of the body. And nodules are hardened areas of muscle that are painful to the touch. All of these terms played a role in how the understanding of fibromyalgia has taken shape over the years. In fact, they've all helped to lead to today's understanding of the condition, that fibromyalgia is caused by a glitch in the way the nervous system processes pain. You'll learn more about this in Chapter 4. More recent developments. Until the late 19th century, doctors thought that the changes in the nervous system that led to fibromyalgia must have a physical cause. But toward the end of the century, this idea changed. That's when an American neurologist came up with the theory that the symptoms of fibromyalgia resulted from life stresses. The idea was that mental or emotional trauma, such as the death of a loved one, business or family troubles, and childbirth, were examples of situations that cause stress overload for some people. In turn, this overload of stress led to fibromyalgia. Nearly a century later, this theory held true. Soldiers admitted to a British Army hospital complained of widespread aches and pains that didn't seem to have a physical cause. The soldiers all had two things in common: depression and stress. Similar cases were seen in U.S. military hospitals at the same time. 50 years later, soldiers with Gulf War syndrome had the same symptoms. This doesn't mean that fibromyalgia is all in a person's head. However, these experiences do suggest that physical and psychological trauma may be a cause of fibromyalgia. In the early 20th century, the term fibrositis came into use. Doctors used this term to describe discomfort caused by swelling in the muscles. This term was used for the next 7 decades. Widespread pain, tender points, fatigue, and sleep problems were all symptoms of fibrositis. Today, all of these are known symptoms of fibromyalgia. By the 1950s, fibrositis became a catch-all diagnosis for people who reported puzzling symptoms. In time, fibrositis was broken down into 2 types, generalized and localized. The generalized form of fibrositis would come to be known as fibromyalgia. In the 1960s, the term fibrositis started to include other symptoms. In turn, a description that's fairly similar to what's used for fibromyalgia today was born. This led to a set of criteria published in the early 1970s that provided the first modern description of what was yet to be called fibromyalgia. It was in 1976 that the term fibromyalgia finally emerged. Its roots lie in Latin and Greek: fibra, for fibrous tissue, myas, for muscles, and algus, for pain. Fibromyalgia timeline. Biblical times. Pain, especially when it can't be explained, is thought to be sent as punishment from the great beyond. 4th century BC. Hippocrates says that pain has a natural cause. 1592. French physician Dr. Guillaume de Bayeux coins the term rheumatism to describe joint and muscle pain similar to what's seen in fibromyalgia today. Late 16th century. Medical literature describes fibromyalgia-like aches and pains. 18th and 19th centuries. Researchers continue to study rheumatism. 1824. Eventually seen as a symptom of fibromyalgia, painful areas of tenderness called tender points are discovered. 1869. American neurologist Dr. George Beard comes up with the term neurasthenia. It means nervous exhaustion and was used to describe symptoms that are now known to be common in fibromyalgia. Dr. Beard blamed the symptoms on life stresses. 1904. British neurologist Sir William Gowers introduced the term fibrositis. Widespread pain, tender points, fatigue, and sleep problems are all symptoms of fibrositis. 1939 to 1940s. During and after World War II, soldiers admitted to a British Army hospital complained of widespread aches and pains that didn't seem to have a physical cause. They all had 2 things in common: depression and stress. Similar cases were seen in U.S. military hospitals. 1950s. The term fibrositis became a catch-all diagnosis for people who reported puzzling symptoms. 1960s. Fibrositis started to include other symptoms, leading to a description that's fairly similar to what's used for fibromyalgia today. Early 1970s. A set of criteria provided the first modern description of what would eventually be called fibromyalgia. 1976. The term fibromyalgia is first used. First a term, then a definition. With an accepted term in place, interest in the condition exploded. Many doctors unfamiliar with how to recognize and diagnose it wanted to learn more. It was a time for an answer to everyone's burning question: what exactly is fibromyalgia? Coming up with an agreed-upon list of symptoms for a fibromyalgia diagnosis would be a feat. Researchers from all over the globe had to weigh in, and there were a lot of differing opinions to sift through. After years of discussion and debate, a group of organizations produced the 1990 American College of Rheumatology criteria for the classification of fibromyalgia. With a list of agreed-upon symptoms in place, this virtually unknown condition moved closer to becoming a household word. Just a few years later, the advent of the Internet offered a buffet of fibromyalgia information to anyone at any time. With this sudden influx of information came new challenges. Doctors, patients, drug manufacturers, and insurance companies all had questions. Is there a medical test to prove someone has fibromyalgia? Is it a psychiatric disorder? When it comes to disability payments, how long and how much? What drugs are used to treat it? How many doctor visits does someone with fibromyalgia need every year? People needed help understanding this condition. To that end, experts got together to revise the 1990 criteria three different times. Learn more about this in Chapter 5. As new discoveries shed new light on fibromyalgia, they'll no doubt be revisited again. What experts know today. Clearly, the understanding of fibromyalgia has evolved over time. Ancient Greeks thought that the pain started in the brain. Centuries later, experts focused on the muscles as the cause. Mental and emotional factors have been blamed as well. No matter what was considered the cause over the years, one thing has remained the same. Fibromyalgia is a pain disorder. Today, a whole-person approach is becoming the standard of care. For example, when doctors diagnose fibromyalgia, they look far beyond just pain. They now know that other symptoms are at play, too. Doctors also realize now that each person's experience with the condition is different and that symptoms can wax and wane. Why the new outlook? Improvements in brain imaging and pain testing have pulled back the veil on the cause of fibromyalgia. This has helped many doctors feel more confident about spotting fibromyalgia in the first place. For example, newer imaging techniques used in research have helped doctors to see that fibromyalgia is linked to changes in the central nervous system. A condition with many names. The term fibromyalgia has been in place since 1976. Before then, it went by quite a few different names. Each name offers a clue as to what researchers thought was the most likely cause of the condition. Swollen tissues, nerve problems, and tense muscles were among the symptoms that played roles in the names fibromyalgia has gone by. You'll see that the suffix algia is common. It's the Greek word for pain. 1592, rheumatism. 1841, neuralgia. 1843, muscle calluses. 1876, chronic rheumatic myitis. 1880, neurasthenia. 1904, fibrositis. 1911, nodular fibromyositis. 1919, muscle gelling. 1921, muscle hardening. 1927, myofasciitis. 1929, myofibrositis. 1930, neurofibrositis. 1930, allergic toxemia. 1937, psychogenic rheumatism. 1940, idiopathic myalgia. 1941, rheumatic myalgia. 1950, tension myalgia. 1951, allergic myalgia. 1952, myofascial pain syndrome. 1955, myodysnuria. 1970, generalized tendomyopathy. 1973, interstitial myofibrositis. 1976, Fibromyalgia. In particular, fibromyalgia is thought to be caused by a disorder called central sensitization. While experts know a lot more about fibromyalgia today than they did centuries ago, research continues. In the next couple of chapters, you'll gain more insights based on what the latest evidence shows. What fibromyalgia is not. Now that you know a little bit about the history of fibromyalgia and how viewpoints have evolved over time, let's talk about what fibromyalgia is not. This will set the stage for Chapter 3, which dives into common myths and facts about the condition. Fibromyalgia isn't deadly. If you don't know a lot about this condition, but have been diagnosed with it, you may be afraid. Afraid of what it is and how it will change your life. Thousands of questions may be zipping through your brain. One question, "Will I die of this?" has a short, simple answer. No. Unlike illnesses that can be terminal, such as cancer, fibromyalgia doesn't shut down your major organs or cause tumors to grow and spread throughout your body. It doesn't harm your joints, muscles, or internal organs. It also doesn't make it more likely that you'll die an earlier death. At the same time, and you likely already know this, fibromyalgia will change your life. But the changes aren't dire, and they're changes you can cope with. You'll learn how as you listen to this audiobook. With the right blend of strategies and a supportive network of friends and family, you can manage this condition. Fibromyalgia isn't a progressive disease. A disease that's progressive spreads or worsens over time. Take multiple sclerosis, for example. It often leads to nerve damage and causes someone to lose the use of muscles. This happens over time. That's what makes it progressive. Fibromyalgia doesn't damage your body over time, so it's not a progressive disease. However, the symptoms may worsen at times. And although fibromyalgia isn't progressive, it can feel progressive. You may also feel as though you're losing ground over time. It may feel harder to get up the stairs this morning or walk to the mailbox today than it did yesterday. But fibromyalgia isn't what's causing these changes. Instead, your level of conditioning is the culprit. Here's how it works. The pain and fatigue of fibromyalgia may lead you to do less over time. When you use your muscles less, you become weaker. If pain and fatigue have you moving simply from bed to chair or from recliner to couch, you are doing less and less. This means you're becoming deconditioned. And as you become more and more deconditioned, daily tasks seem harder to do or even impossible. When this happens, you may stop going upstairs or sweeping the porch altogether. When you stop doing the daily tasks of living, this is actually what makes you become deconditioned. The good news is that you can completely regain all of the strength that you feel you have lost. You'll learn how in Chapter 13. Fibromyalgia isn't a chronic infection, such as Lyme disease. If you've ever had a chronic infection, such as Lyme disease, you may see some similarities between the symptoms you had then and the symptoms you have with fibromyalgia. Fatigue, joint pain, muscle pain, and stomach issues are among them. While some symptoms of a chronic infection may mimic fibromyalgia, fibromyalgia itself isn't a chronic infection. However, a serious infection can trigger fibromyalgia. Having fibromyalgia doesn't make you a hypochondriac. Perhaps you never used to worry about your health, but now, with fibromyalgia, maybe you've become concerned about the symptoms that this condition creates on a daily basis. You may wonder a number of things. Am I having a heart attack? Do I have appendicitis? Do I need to go to the emergency room? Do I have a brain tumor? Did I somehow break my ankle? It's not uncommon for someone with fibromyalgia to visit doctor after doctor for some time before finally receiving a diagnosis. In fact, it can take several years to get a diagnosis. After completing a series of tests, all with normal results, your doctor may feel that your symptoms aren't real or blame them on depression or stress. In the meantime, your family and friends may think you're a person who complains about symptoms that aren't real, hypochondriac. It's important to remember that the symptoms you experience with fibromyalgia are real. The term health anxiety may better describe what you're feeling. Before learning they have fibromyalgia, many people feel isolated and begin to question if what others are saying might be true. You may have asked yourself, am I losing my mind? Is it all in my head? Even though more is known today than ever before about this condition, questions still remain, and fibromyalgia is still often underdiagnosed and undertreated. Through it all, the bottom line to always remember is this: your symptoms are real, and fibromyalgia is a real and treatable condition. Chapter 3. Myths versus Facts. It's no secret that fibromyalgia has a credibility problem. Just take an informal poll among friends or do a quick search on the internet. From average people on the street to doctors who've been practicing medicine for years, some truly understand fibromyalgia while others don't know much about it. To help move you forward in your understanding of fibromyalgia, this chapter outlines several myths about the condition and uncovers the truth behind each one. Solving a mystery. In Chapter 2, you heard about the history of fibromyalgia. You also learned about how things have changed over the years in terms of what's known about it. Fibromyalgia is still fairly young in terms of what is known about it. After all, the word fibromyalgia has been around only since 1976, and it wasn't officially defined until the 1990s. With that said, fibromyalgia tends to provoke many questions. Your doctor may wonder, how can you tell the difference between fibromyalgia and a different condition, such as arthritis or depression? These symptoms are all over the place. What tests should I order for this patient? What's the best treatment to advise? At the same time, you may be wondering, will I ever feel better? What damage is this doing to my body? Am I going to have this for the rest of my life? What's wrong with me? A lot of research has been done on fibromyalgia since it was first recognized by the American College of Rheumatology in 1990. Even so, answering questions like these takes time. Chances are, you didn't know many, if any, other people who had fibromyalgia before learning you have it. Even today, fibromyalgia is a condition that's still largely unrecognized. Medical professionals are at all different points along the learning curve. Fibromyalgia is a challenging mystery. It can be seen as a whodunit of sorts, or maybe more of a whatdunit. Although many people love good mysteries, most people also love to solve them. In the interest of solving fibromyalgia, here's a look at the many theories floating around about it. What follows are the most common myths about fibromyalgia and the truths behind them. Myth 1. Fibromyalgia isn't real. This is the top misconception about fibromyalgia. People sometimes think that fibromyalgia isn't a real medical problem or that it's all in your head. Fibromyalgia symptoms can be so vague that they could apply to any number of conditions. Plus, who hasn't felt sore, tired, or moody, or all of those things at once on a regular basis? Truth: many, if not most, medical illnesses aren't seen as real until more is known about them. At one point, even asthma was thought to be a made-up condition. Rheumatoid arthritis was once thought to be an infection. In both cases, knowing more about how they developed led to better understanding, as well as better ways to diagnose and treat them. Fibromyalgia has been, and in some circles, is still in the same situation. More pieces of the puzzle are coming together every day. Bottom line, fibromyalgia is caused by a real problem happening within the body. It's thought to be caused by a glitch in how the brain and nerves throughout the spinal cord process pain signals. As a result, people with fibromyalgia react more strongly to pain and many other sensations. Myth 2. Fibromyalgia is a mental health disorder. Fibromyalgia can be hard to diagnose. When one test after another comes back with no solid answers, some doctors may wonder if a patient's symptoms are actually related to a mental health condition, instead of something that's physically happening in the body. Truth. While symptoms of fibromyalgia may be related to things going on in your mind, such as stress and depression, fibromyalgia itself isn't in your head. Fibromyalgia is a medical disorder, not a mental health disorder, and it isn't caused by a mental health disorder, although you'll learn in this audiobook that stress can play a role in your symptoms and in fibromyalgia in general. It's also important to note that having any kind of medical condition can make a person feel anxious or depressed. If you feel frustrated that you have a chronic condition that seems to get in the way of everything, you aren't alone. Bottom line, fibromyalgia is a real physical condition. It's caused by a miscommunication between the nerves in your body and your brain. Myth 3. Fibromyalgia is an autoimmune disorder. Autoimmune disorders affect more than 23 million people in the U.S., and they can involve nearly any part of the body, inside and out. It's your autoimmune system's job to fight off viruses and bacteria before they make you sick. When you have an autoimmune disorder, your immune system mistakenly attacks healthy cells instead. There are more than 80 conditions labeled as autoimmune disorders. Some common ones are rheumatoid arthritis, Hashimoto's disease, celiac disease, and lupus. Fibromyalgia isn't on the list. Here's why. Truth. The idea that the body can turn against itself has been around only since the turn of the 20th century. Around the same time, experts were trying to better understand fibromyalgia, known as fibrositis back then. At that time, what would eventually be called fibromyalgia was placed in the same category as rheumatoid arthritis. It was labeled as an autoimmune disorder. Doctors would learn later on that about 1 in 4 people with fibromyalgia also has an autoimmune disorder. This finding led to fibromyalgia remaining lumped together with autoimmune disorders. But fibromyalgia isn't an autoimmune disorder. Fibromyalgia and autoimmune disorders, and many other conditions for that matter, often share many symptoms. Joint and muscle pain, swelling, muscle weakness, and fatigue are all examples. But the blood tests used to diagnose autoimmune disorders aren't used to diagnose fibromyalgia. Plus, a physical exam is often enough for a doctor to be able to tell if you have an autoimmune disorder or fibromyalgia. Put simply, they're two different types of conditions. That also means that medications used to treat an autoimmune disorder can't address symptoms of fibromyalgia. One more difference between autoimmune disorders and fibromyalgia. Autoimmune disorders often cause permanent damage in the body, including to skin and joints. Fibromyalgia doesn't damage your body. Bottom line, although fibromyalgia can...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.